Good morning and welcome to worship this morning. Glad for those of you who are joining with us in the sanctuary, and for those of you who are joining with us on our live stream, we welcome you and we join with you and we join our spirits together in worshiping and praising God. This indeed is a day which the Lord has made, to rejoice, to be glad in it, and so we will rejoice and be glad in this beautiful day that the Lord has made to join together to worship and to fellowship and to praise God's name. We are so grateful today for the way God continues to bless us. We have wonderful musicians, and so our guest organist today is David Holland. And David Holland is the organist currently at Meadowbrook Congregational Church in Novi. But before that, he was the organist at Metropolitan United Methodist Church. He followed Gail Kramer there, and so we've been fortunate to get two of the former organists at Metropolitan to play for us during this time while Larissa's been away. We look forward to Larissa's return soon in the next few weeks, and she continues to report that she's doing well and the baby is doing well, and so we're looking forward to that. So again, we are grateful for the way God continues to work and bless and give us His grace and to give us wonderful musicians and people to help us in worship service. We continue our worship this morning. We begin our worship with our call to worship, which is based on Psalm 47. So we invite you to join here and join online as Anita leads us in this call to worship.
Sing praises
to our sovereign Lord.
God is Our scripture today is from Acts 1 through 11 and from Luke 24, 44 to 53. I, in my former book, Theopolis, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving instruction through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "No." He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and the cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside him. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand there looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." And this is Luke 24, 44 to 53. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written: the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witness of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." When he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple praising God. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Bow with me for a word of prayer. Gracious God, we give thanks for your presence with us, for your Holy Spirit that you promised to send. We are recipients of that promise. So today, as we gather, we pray that your Holy Spirit would fall upon us in a special way and give us new insights and give us awareness, give us an open mind as you opened the disciples' mind to understand the scriptures. We pray that as we join together, that the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
In Jan Karen's novel, At Home in Mitford, there's a passage, a scene in which Father Tim comes into a darkened sanctuary late at night, a sanctuary probably somewhat like this. And as he comes into the sanctuary, he's aware of a stranger, another person that's in the sanctuary there praying. And at first, the person who is praying, the prayer is inaudible, but gradually it gets louder and louder and louder until finally the person raises his hands and looks up at the ceiling and kind of shouts to the top of his lungs, "If you're up there, prove it." Father Tim quietly slips behind him, puts a hand on his shoulder, and says to him, "I think the question you need to be asking is not, are you up there, but rather, are you down here?"
Are you here with me, God? So we come to this last Sunday of Eastertide, this Sunday that historically has been identified in the church calendar as Ascension Sunday. In Luke's calendar, Luke's kind of chronology, the ascension of Jesus took place 40 days after his resurrection. And so the church celebrates this event. We read Luke's account of the ascension of Jesus. I say accounts because most scholars are in agreement that Luke, the writer of Luke's gospel, also wrote Acts and probably intended to write maybe a third volume and never got a chance to do that. I love the way the angels in the Acts account appear before the men, the disciples. Here are the disciples following the followers of Jesus, that they've been with Jesus all along, and now they come to this event, the time when Jesus ascends back to glory, and I'm sure they're wondering, what are they going to do? What's going to happen? And they're all standing there looking up in the sky, and the angel says, "Men of Galilee." I like the way he says "men of Galilee." In other words, he's kind of saying, "Country bumpkins, you country bumpkins, you know, what are you doing standing there looking up at the sky, you know, staring at space? You know, you look kind of befuddled." And the angel says, "Don't you get it that this same Jesus who ascended is going to come back?" Now, when we hear that in our kind of modern times, we hear kind of the idea, oh yeah, Jesus is going to come back at some point and at the end of time and scoop up all the good people and take them to the good place and leave all the rest of the people here to stew in their own juices, and to use a phrase of N.T. Wright, to kind of just, you know, muddle along and the world can kind of go to hell in a handbasket, but all the good people are going to be gone. And no, that's really not in keeping with much of what the New Testament says. In fact, it's not really in keeping with what we're going to pray in a few minutes in this worship service. We're going to pray the Lord's Prayer. And the Lord's Prayer, the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to say, is, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." In other words, Jesus is King of kings and Lord of lords, of heaven and earth. In fact, the Bible ends in Revelations with the glorious scene in which God makes his presence among his people, among those on earth in this restored and new creation that God will accomplish. And so we look ahead to that time when God's plan for not only individuals, God's plan of salvation will be complete for us, but will be complete for all of creation. Like Paul says in Romans, that creation groans and waits in travail like a woman in labor, waiting for that time when God will set everything right and make this world part of heaven. We'll make it what God intended it to be in the first place. And we'll make his dwelling place, his home with us. But even now, Jesus is with us. The risen Christ is with us. The Holy Spirit is with us. I remember kind of growing up, early in my seminary experience, a famous book that was kind of making the rounds was called "Are You Running With Me, Jesus?" That's maybe the question that we really are asking. I think the question that maybe the disciples are asking as they experience this ascension of Jesus back to glory, but they're asking, but are you running with me still, Jesus? Are you going with us? Are you going with us? Jesus tells his disciples to wait in both accounts. That's one of the things that ties the two accounts together very clearly, is that Jesus tells his disciples to wait. Now, and he says to wait in the city until the Holy Spirit empowers them, gives them power, gives them strength, gives them something that they do not possess. Now, this waiting is not passive waiting. It's not, you know, just kind of sitting around staring off into space like the angel said, or sitting around twiddling your thumbs, or sitting around on the mountain waiting for Jesus to return. That's not what Jesus is instructing his disciples to do. He's instructing them to wait with anticipation, to actively wait, to wait for power. In active waiting, we gain a sense, I think, first of all, of our helplessness. I remember when, and I mentioned this before, when my daughter Jolie was in her severe car pedestrian accident, I remember getting the word and jumping in my car to drive up to Flint where she was, and I can remember just feeling so helpless, and all I could do in the car was just continually pray over and over, please God, please God, please God. In other words, help me, help. I'm powerless. Please God, help me. Waiting in the city. I think it's interesting that Jesus says to wait in the city. The city, in a sense, is a metaphor. The city can be such a metaphor of need. If you listen in the city, I mean, maybe in the city more than any place else, you can hear all around you, if you really listen, the cries going up, the prayers ascending for help. Help me. Help me financially. Help me with justice. Help me with righteousness. Help me overcome the afflictions. Help me in so many ways. The cries of desperate prayers for help. The disciples needed to wait and listen. Wait in the city, maybe, as a metaphor. They needed to learn to pray for help. The city is a parable, a metaphor not only for prayer, it is also a metaphor of human community. It is in the city that we learn best that everyone is not just like we are. Indeed, it was in the city that the disciples learned that the community of Jesus is broader than we have imagined or they had imagined. It was in a city called Nain that they learned that the kingdom embraced widows and prostitutes. That the man whose name was Legion, remember that man who had the legion of demons, was from a city. And Luke and Matthew both tell the parable of the great banquet where those who were invited made excuses. And so the host sent the servant out to bring in enough guests for the banquet. Go out into the streets and lanes and into the city. Luke is very emphatic about putting that in, making sure that he puts it in. Words of Jesus, go into the streets and lanes of the city and bring in the poor and the maimed and the blind and the lame. Parker Palmer has remarked that the church speaks about community, but it's often an idealized community. We talk about the church family or koinonia groups, but what we really mean to describe is a group of people who look like us and act like us. Such images of community are idolatrous. They're not really in keeping with the word koinonia in the New Testament. That is why the real city, not the make-believe city, is the place where the church can best learn about kingdom community. Palmer offers this definition of community. Community is that place where the person you least want to live with always lives. And when that person moves away, someone else arises to take his or her place. And the disciples needed to learn what community was. Not community a group of 12 guys that looked all like them, but a group of people that looked so much different. Next week we're going to celebrate Pentecost, and that when the Holy Spirit came in power to those disciples that were meeting, it says that they went out into the streets and started spreading the good news, and it says that there were people there from everywhere, that there were Arabic people, and there were street people, and there were people from Parthia and Mede and from Africa and from everywhere, and they heard the gospel in their own language, the good news. The disciples needed to wait in the city until they received the power to understand and to know what real community was like. In this sense, every place where the church is planted is, in its own way, a city. There is no village so small, no place so isolated, that there is not at least some taste of the richness, the challenge, and quite frankly, the gratifying difficulty of human differences. If it is there in the wide diversity of the city where it may be found, the disciples confront the sobering fact that without the Holy Spirit's power, they could not and we cannot keep Jesus' command. Remember the passage we read just last week where Jesus' command to his disciples was, "A new commandment I give you, that you love others the way I have loved you." But isn't that so hard? Don't we find that so difficult? Don't we fail at that so often in our own strength? It is in that city place that we say, "I'm sorry," that we confess our inadequacies, that we confess our weakness, that we say to God, "I'm sorry. I'm not able to love my neighbor as I should, to love others the way you love." The Christian life is one of constant admission that we are sinners in need of forgiveness and therefore ready to forgive others and ourselves. As we say our confessions, we have the confidence that transgressions will always be trumped by God's forgiveness and pardon. I'm indebted to Leonard Sweet for this idea of these four simple words of the gospel. So after help and I'm sorry, the great message of the gospel is thank you. Thank you. In Luke's account of the ascension, particularly in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus comes, the risen Christ comes into the midst of the disciples, and the first thing he does is that he shows them his hands and his side, his wounds. He says, in effect, to them, "This is how much I love you, how much I care about you. This is what lengths I will go to save you and rescue you and make you new and forgive you." He shows them how much he loves them. The risen Christ bears the marks of his suffering and his sacrifice. And the response of the disciples is the correct response. It says that they fell on their knees, they worshiped him. Worship really boils down to simply saying, "Thank you. Thank you for giving yourself for me. Thank you for the gift of salvation. Thank you for this new life that I have in Christ." And note that it was after the ascension, after Christ had ascended, that they worshiped him. They worshiped him in the Acts account. In other words, they worshiped, they understood that now Jesus wasn't just going to make a few appearances, you know, and then slowly those appearances would kind of peter out and things would go back to normal and they would forget about Jesus. But now Jesus could be everywhere. Jesus could be with them. power of the Holy Spirit. They worshiped him. And after we cry for help, and we say, I'm sorry, and we worship and we say, thank you, it says the disciples experienced great joy. Great joy. After thank you, after sorry, after please or help me, the disciples and the witnesses at Jesus' ascension experienced their final interaction with their Lord, and it was an experience of joy. Joy not in the kind of emotion that we think of, joy not equated so much with happiness. There would certainly be a lot of sorrow and heartache along the way for the disciples, but it's that joy that we sing about sometimes. Remember that little song? I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. The joy of Jesus is more than just emotional happiness. This joy comes when we say yes to God. And yes to God's call to us. So the question today, I think the question for the disciples was, have you said yes to Jesus? Have you said yes to God? Have you said yes to God's ultimate yes to us and to creation? That's what Paul says, that Jesus Christ, the risen Christ, is God's ultimate yes to us and to all creation. So the ascension is the celebration that Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that he is with us even now, as he said, to the end of the age. We look to that time. We work for that time. We work for the kingdom so that we anticipate his kingdom coming, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I love this little story that I came across. It's a story about a neighborhood grocery store. It was in a fairly affluent town and this grocery store was visited every morning by the same clearly non-affluent person. For our purposes, we could call her Ruth. And she was a street person. She entered the grocery about 11 a.m. every day and made her way through the aisles. There is really no polite way to say what she does. Ruth steals food. Each morning, she gathers enough for her lunch, poking pieces of fruit and loaves of bread, wedges of cheese, a can of meat under her torn and stained coat. She then glides out the door. But she is not very subtle about it. Everyone in the store can see what she's doing. The stockroom crew knows that she's taking food. The butcher sees her activity. The checkout clerks are aware of her pilfering. The manager knows what she is doing. The owner of the store knows about Ruth. Not long ago, this grocery store moved several blocks away to a larger building. The week they moved to the new location, the store manager, by instruction of the owner, telephoned a downtown pastor. He says, I don't want to embarrass Ruth, he began, so would you please find her and tell her where we've moved? I want to be sure she can find us. There is a parable of mercy. An urban grocery store owner wants to be sure a homeless person, this urban grocery store owner, was a believer, a disciple, following Christ in his way, in his call. And he wants to be sure that a homeless woman, a woman very much unlike the owner, can nonetheless find food. For disciples with discerning eyes, there is much to learn here about the power of God in our world. Stay in the city. Wait in the city. With your eyes open, anticipating, open to the grace of God. And you will receive power. The Holy Spirit will speak into your lives. There is a historian named Ramsay McMullen. He's written a book entitled The Christianizing of the Roman Empire. It was an attempt to write a secular history of the early Christian movement. He points out that for the first 250 years, from Paul to Constantine, Christianity grew because of the witness of Christians. After Paul, he says, there was no church mission, no strategy, no organization to win non-Christians to Christ. They didn't have a plan. They didn't have a strategic approach that they were going to take. Just every Christian, every person who was a follower of Christ lived out their faith and shared their faith with others. And the Christian church, he says, in that first 200 years, grew by 500,000 people every generation. Simply because people lived out. They waited with anticipation. They waited for the power of the Holy Spirit to enliven them and to empower them, and they went out into the world, changed the world for Christ. May we wait in the city until we are clothed with power.
this are these prayer requests. Prayers for the Vorsees family for the loss of her mother and grandmother due to COVID. We pray for Jan Wood's sister, Gail, who is recovering from hip replacement surgery. We pray for Deanna Tarpley for traveling mercies as she goes to Mexico to see her sister. We pray for Bentley Dodson, who is in intensive care in Alabama for seizures related to lung health. So we add these to our prayer list. Would you bow with me for prayer? Gracious God, we give thanks for your continued faithfulness to us. We thank you for the fact that we are invited to come into your presence without fear, with complete confidence and assurance that you know our needs and you hear our prayers. So Lord, we lift up all of these prayer concerns, prayers for healing and wholeness, prayers for traveling mercies, prayers for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. We pray that you would send your peace, your strength, your grace, your protection. Lord, we lift up those who are working for your kingdom in many places of the world that are difficult and where they face real challenges. Lord, we pray that you would be with those who are working to bring peace, especially. That song sung so well reminds us that peace begins with us. May you give us strength and empower us to be people of peace, people who speak peace into others' troubled hearts and lives. Lord, we pray that you would be with those who actively are working for peace and an end to fighting and bloodshed and hatred. We pray that you would give them strength and give them your power. We pray now for all of our brothers and sisters in Christ who are worshiping today, many in different parts of the world. We are reminded as we think of them, of the diversity, the family that we are part of as followers of Christ. People who are very different from us. People who don't use our language, worship in our way, but who are your followers, and whose hearts are in tune with yours. And so we join with all of them in praying together the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is, We Have a Story to Tell to the Nations. It's 569. For those of you joining us online who have a hymnal or know the song, can join along. And for those of you, hopefully as more and more of you are vaccinated, we can begin to relax some of the restrictions, and hopefully we'll get to a time when we can all sing together. That will be glorious. Till then, join in listening to our singers.
Thank you.
Just a few announcements that I'll share with you. Again, just want to express appreciation for all the volunteers that helped with the yard sale, the estate sale. And then Bible study is at 4 o'clock. We have two more sessions before we break for the summer. So if you'd like to join us for that, make sure that I have your email address. And I can send you the Zoom link. And I did have one announcement here that I was going to read. We received word, request actually, that if anyone has a home that they are willing to rent, we have someone who is looking for a home to rent. This person has income and can rent, but is going through some hard times physically and is looking for a place to rent. So if you have such a place, if you let us know, we can put you in touch with this family who needs a place to rent. In 2 weeks, next week is Pentecost, and so we're going to be celebrating Pentecost. If you want to wear red, that's a good time to wear red. Connie's got red on today. And we'll be celebrating Pentecost Sunday. And then the Sunday after that will be Memorial Day, or Memorial Sunday. We'll be celebrating Memorial. And one of the things that I'd like to do is invite you, if you have a loved one, especially a loved one who served in the armed services, maybe who is passed on or who perished in fighting and defending the country, if you would just let us know. And we're going to give you an opportunity to remember them during that memorial service in 2 weeks. And so be thinking about that. I think those are the announcements that I have. Receive this blessing and benediction. We're going to use the prayer of St. Ignatius. Teach us, O Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for any reward, except that of knowing that we do your will. We ask this through Jesus Christ, and God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit will rest upon you and go with you as you go out into the world to be witnesses to the risen Christ.